Hello, it's David Perlman here for the Whole Note Studio. My guest today is Serouj Kradjian, who is one of the three artistic directors of Amici. You're the new kid on the block with Amici, relatively speaking. David Hetherington and Joaquin Valdepeñas have been with the group from its inception, haven't they?
Founding members, yes.
Along with Patricia Parr,
yes.
Who was the original keyboard anchor for the group. And that is your role now. You're the pianist in the group. How many years is it now with Amici for you?
This will be the fifth season.
For you?
For me.
Wow. Time flies
quickly, yes.
Too fast. Yeah. I remember years ago talking to Patricia about the group and talking about the name of the group, Amici. And on the one hand, you are a trio, but it's an unusual combination of instruments. It's not as stable a configuration as a piano trio, is it?
I think at the very start, there was a practical reason for this, because there simply wasn't enough material written for clarinet, piano, cello combination. And that's how it started, the idea of expanding the group to include other instrumentalists and in a way making friendships, new friendships through music, or making music through friendship.
So Amici is not the name of the trio so much as the practice of the
group.
Yes,
and the concept.
Always, and the concept.
Yes.
So the repertoire obviously expands enormously once you add to that infrastructure.
Definitely. I mean, it can expand as far as the Schubert Octet.
Right.
Or the over 25 pieces that Amici has commissioned over the years for the core formation.
Core or core plus, do they commission for both, or have they commissioned mostly for core?
Mostly for core. There have been some instances where it was core plus, but mostly it was for, because there is definitely a shortage for this combination. And this reminds me as well of what the Verder trio did for the clarinet violin piano combination. They commissioned, and they had over 100 pieces in their existence.
In the repertoire.
In their repertoire, and they really enriched the library for this combination.
So in terms of this coming season, is there a commitment to one signature just for the core on every program, or is that doesn't work that way necessarily?
Not necessarily. In fact, I don't know if we even have any pieces programmed for the core formation this year. So that has never been, that is not a priority.
It's not an obsession to always do it.
Exactly.
I understand. So in the coming season, you have a lineup of Amici friends that you're bringing in for different concerts, and they don't repeat very much. The season, I noticed it was interesting from the brochure that they're different additional people each time, so it's not going back to the same circle of one or two additional players each time.
We emphasize on eclectic programming, and this coming season we have went even a step further, whereas where our guests or our new friends are not only musicians, but there is a chef, there is a visual artist, there is a food critic, there are the music critics in our second program, and there is a fashion designer. So in a way, we're expanding our circle of friends through our series.
So bringing music into conjunction with other arts.
Arts, exactly.
And culinary arts is the focus of the first one.
Yes, and
that's... We might as well go right. It's coming up this coming week, right? Tomorrow, 1 week.
1 week, yes.
At the Glenn Gould Studio. And the name of the first one, La Bonne Cuisine.
It's inspired by the song cycle that Leonard Bernstein wrote,
right.
Which is a group of four songs based on the lyrics of which are based on recipes of four different
dishes. I don't know the songs.
It's a very, very witty and genius work, actually.
And the friend for that work is who?
Is Alin Kutan,
okay.
Soprano Alin Kutan.
She was here for Queen of the Night
just recently.
Night.
Yes, and also about a couple of weeks ago, the CBC celebrated its 75th anniversary mm-hmm. at the Glen Gould Studio, and she also was there with the COC Orchestra. So she is very famous for the Queen of the Night, but she's not only that, and she will really show her other
she
sides
gets, she gets
as
to
well.
Show her other sides. So that particular piece is scored for what?
For piano and voice.
Piano and voice.
But of course, we also have other pieces such as the Shepherd on the Rock.
Right.
And also L'Amero from Mozart's Il Re Pastore opera. It's the aria for piano, violin accompanying the voice. And she's one of the guests, of course.
And who are the others?
Marie Bérard, the concertmaster of the COC Orchestra. She's going to join us for the Poulenc's L'Invitation au Château. It's one of his works, which is not even published.
Yeah.
He wrote it as incidental music for a theater piece.
And it's for what combination?
It's for violin, clarinet, and piano.
Okay.
Yeah.
So David sits out that one.
David sits out. But he joins us for La Revue, the mm-hmm. cuisine, which is by Martinu,
right.
And it's for a bigger ensemble. It's for bassoon, trumpet, double bass, cello, piano, violin, and clarinet. It's a bigher ensemble, and it describes the goings on in a kitchen. Through different dances, actually. There's a Charleston in there, there's a tango, there is through different dances.
You can imagine what's going on in the kitchen for the tango, but... so it's an interesting question when one comes up with combinations of instruments, I'm just speculating, but I wonder how often people composed... because the ensemble knew the how often were pieces for an eclectic assembly like of instruments like that because that's what the composer wanted to compose to or because that's what the commissioner wanted them to compose for? Or is this a relatively new phenomenon of the ensemble saying to the composer, here are the ingredients, now mm-hmm. come up with the recipe?
It's an interesting question because as you go back in time, there are less and less works which go out of the traditional norm of violin, cello, and piano, let's mm-hmm. say a trio, or a quintet, string quartet. But, as early as, for example, Saint-Saëns with his septet, mm-hmm. or Schubert, of course, with the octet, mm-hmm. non-traditional. With Martinu, for example, and as I think it becomes a more popular form of chamber music mm-hmm. In the 20th century, and it gets more and more interesting with the combination of instruments mm-hmm. combined. And I think, I think it's 50-50 between the commissioner mm-hmm. wanting something interesting, an interesting orchestra, or the composer coming up with an interesting combination of instruments.
So in the curatorial aspect of your job, when you're starting to put together a season that has a theme like this one does, where four concerts, right? Mm-hmm. First concert, culinary. Second concert in December
is critics.
Different kind of recipe. You've asked different critics to say... That's putting the next thing would be to invite them as guests so that one can throw stones at the stone throwers. Yeah. So the third concert then is
the fashion designer.
That's Rosemary Umetsu, who has worked with other ensembles in terms of this concept of bringing fashion to to the presentation, yes, and yes, yes. Has a very interesting eye or ear, I'm not sure which to say, for fashion.
I think her inspiration from the very beginning has been classical artists.
Really?
You know, and that's how her art of fashion design blossoms, uh-huh. through them. And I think this is an excellent, this will be an excellent collaboration. In fact, the piece that we have commissioned, mm-hmm. Especially for that concert by Toronto composer Alice Ho.
Yes.
She actually wrote her piece inspired by Rosemary's art, Rosemary's fashion designs. And the piece is called Breath of Fire.
Oh, yeah.
And it's actually inspired by the colors and the designs of Rosemary Umezzo.
And that's a trio work, but not for the core trio.
That's when I rest a bit.
Joseph Petrich?
Joseph Petrich joining the accordion. Joining
the poor man's piano. He's a fine player.
Definitely.
Yeah. So that's the third one. And then the fourth one, somebody is actually painting on...
Literally painting the music. Okay. We're going to do a very, very interesting piece, rarely performed by Janacek. It's mm-hmm. called the Capriccio. And it was written for left-hand piano, accompanied by the winds, by brass and woodwinds. And he actually wrote it for somebody who had lost his right arm in the First World War.
Okay.
And it's a mesmerizing piece. I didn't even know about it.
Mm-hmm.
She's going to literally paint the music. And in the first half, we have pieces such as Piero Luner, experts from that, so the Debussy cello sonata, works which have a very close relationship to the visual arts.
Very colored works that have a lot of color in them.
Definitely.
So in the curatorial process, I imagine sometimes a theme comes to the fore and then you say, okay, so who will the players be and what will the repertoire be? But that there must also be an aspect of, these are people we really want to work with this year. What kind of, how much of it is building around the people that you want to work with from year to year, and how much of it is, this is the theme, so these are the troops we need?
Again, the priorities shift. Sometimes it's a piece, and sometimes it's the artists we really want to invite. For example, for the fashion concert, mm-hmm. Since we had chosen Chausson, the concerto for violin and piano accompanied by string quartet, I just imagined that it should be Laura St. John,
right? Okay.
And it should be the string quartet should be the Cecilia string quartet, because I think by thinking of fashion.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful women on stage.
Are they going to play standing? Or are they going to play sitting?
Well, it's such a long word.
It's
50 minutes long. It would be.
All right, they can sit.
Yeah, it would be crime.
Flat-heeled shoes,
commissioner. Something.
Yeah,
but as I said, the priorities change, mm-hmm. But it's definitely sometimes the leading, let's say. The priority would be the artist, and sometimes the priority would be the work or the theme.
Of this whole season or of the concert?
The individual concerts as well.
Uh-huh. And this year, where the theme seems, did the overall theme arise from the individual themes, or was there more of a sense of this is the overall shape of the season that we...
This year was rather unique, actually, because in previous seasons, for example, we had a concert programmed around the theme of Levant, of the region what is the Middle East today, and it was really interesting to go and investigate pieces, first of all, by renowned composers who were inspired by this region, by its religions, by its cultures, by the sounds of its music, or find out about composers who are lesser known, but they have produced music which should be heard. But for this season, we really wanted to go a step further. Mm-hmm. And what better way to investigate things which are so necessary for the human being, like mm-hmm. food, like visual art, like reading newspapers about. So we went, that's what I think. I think we went a step further.
More of a unified sense.
Exactly. And the challenge was to find music which justifies the cause of the themes of the seasons, of the season.
So for this kind of the intimacy of scale, you couldn't do something like the painting or even the fashion in an 800 or 900 seat house. It seems to me that the scale of the Gould, of the Glenn Gould studio, is actually a very interesting part of the effectiveness of this kind of work.
We've always liked the intimacy that the mm-hmm. Glenn Gould studio offers, especially for chamber music generally, but especially for this type of a theme for a season that we want. There's this connection to the audience that, as you said, I mean, in an 800-seat house, in a 1,000-seat house, it's more difficult to create that connection to the audience. We really want the audience to really be part of the goings-on of the stage, rather than establish this certain distance, which is also good in some situations.
Sure.
But this inclusiveness of the audience in the goings-on on the stage is very important, especially for this season.
Right. It's an interesting thing in that room, because it's part of it is the scale of the house, but part of it is the height of the stage.
Of the stage.
If you're four rows back, you're already above the height of the wrists of the pianist. So there's a lovely close focus to the place. And will you be using the lobby areas? I'm imagining for this first one with the food components that's utilizing the space to its full capacity.
I mean, it would have been a dream to have part of the program play the concert while people are enjoying themselves eating and drinking. But I think we'll, as a first attempt, we would be a bit more conservative and use the lobby.
I think so. I think audiences don't need any excuse for rudeness in our day and age. Okay, that's most of what I wanted to ask you in terms of Amici, and I wanted to also ask you, well, what else? Amici is not everything that you do. You mentioned, for example, that you, with Aline Coutan, that you're piano and voice. Mm-hmm. And as an accompanist, you do a lot of work, or a collaborative pianist is the phrase some would use, but you...
Well, I mean... When my wife is Isabel Bayraktarian, so we do a lot together. In fact, this Friday, a couple of days before the Amici concert, we're doing a concert in Markham.
Right, that is they're making a big push with that place to really up the intensity and focus series, of their
definitely.
Classical music.
Yeah.
So that's this Friday.
This Friday, a couple of days before.
And what's the repertoire for that one?
We have tried to put a program together which investigates songs written by piano virtuosos or composers who have written also well for the piano.
Okay.
Celebrating the 200th anniversary of Franz Liszt. Mm-hmm. We start with his songs. Mm-hmm. Then I play an etude by Liszt. We have, for example, Rossini, she sings the Rosina Zaria.
Right.
Then I follow it up with a very virtuoso transcription of Figaro's aria Largo et Factotum by Ginsburg. It's a very good transcription for a piano solo. We have a tango group of songs, but I also play the Albéniz Godowski transcription of Albéniz's tango. So we really try to combine...
Mixing it up.
I think it's an interesting program. We haven't performed these pieces before in Toronto.
Right.
So it will be a good premiere of this type of...
Do you have any programs that you tour with her as recitals? Do you try to build in work together, or do you, as part of... I mean, it's the question of musical families is a very interesting one in terms of seeking to work together, but also, you know, thank God, sometimes not working together at all, you know, because how does that work with you?
I've always had a curious mind of trying to find, as I do in my work with Amici, trying to find works which haven't had their place under the sun. Mm-hmm. You know, they and I really try to combine those relatively unknown works with the renowned, I mean, works by more renowned composers. Mm-hmm. But the challenge there is to have a focus right. in the program. I mean, you can't just put, oh, you know, I just like to present these works, but it has really no place in the program. That would not work. So I'm very happy in my role as a researcher, uh-huh. as finding out works or composers to present them anew, but also to have a meaning. For example, it's been 4 years actually that we did this recording of the songs of Pauline Viardot Garcia, which won a Juno Award.
Yeah.
And it took a lot of research. I mean, I went as far as Paris to actually find some of her scores in mm-hmm. the National Library there. And it's very interesting because, for example, her father, Manuel Garcia, was the first Figaro. He premiered actually the role of Figaro in Barbara of Seville for Rossini, of Rossini.
Wow!
And he was also a great voice pedagogue actually. So it was an interesting connection once we did, and she was also very close to Frédéric Chopin. Actually,
right.
Chopin insisted that she sing and play. She was also a very good pianist mm-hmm. at his farewell concert. So it was interesting. Once we did a program of Chopin, Rossini, mm-hmm. and Viardot.
Simply one after the other. One can find the connective tissue.
Exactly. Exactly. And of course, Viardot had very, very good transcriptions of some of Chopin's mazurkas. She found words for them, and the result is very charming, actually.
Uh-huh. And have you toured that program as a live program?
We did that. We've done Viardot songs a lot.
All over.
All over. Yeah.
Do you have another such program in the planning for the two of you?
I rather keep it secret. But as I said, I really enjoy that part of my. Mm-hmm. job, let's say, both for Amici, for solo repertoire, and for voice and piano.
Uh-huh. And in terms of voice and piano, are there any other people you work with regularly as a collaborative pianist?
Not regularly, but of course I've worked with Russell Braun, with Michael Schade. I'm mm-hmm. really looking forward to working with Aline Coutin. She's mm-hmm. a great artist. Mm-hmm. I've had the chance to work with Don Opshaw. Mm-hmm. A year ago, actually, when she visited Toronto, we did some Schubert songs, some Golikov, some compositions.
I was going to ask if there was a modern component, because she's a shining practitioner of modern repertoire.
And she champions the work of Ozolda Golikov, whom mm-hmm. I really is one of my idols, actually, of mm-hmm. the modern composers. I enjoy working with artists, I mean, to enjoy mm-hmm. new repertoire.
And orchestrally, working as a pianist, do you maintain an active concerto schedule,
or
does something have to give in the overall?
Definitely, but mostly these past years, my activities as a composer, have taken over. I composed, actually, it was commissioned by the CBC. Mm-hmm. I composed a work for Isabel, accompanied by the Manitoba Chamber Orchestra.
Okay. They were just in town a couple of weeks ago. Yeah?
Yes, and right before that, actually, we were in Banff premiering my work.
Okay.
We did a couple of performances, in one in Manitoba, one in Winnipeg, and one in Banff, mm-hmm. which was actually broadcast not live, but it was taped for the CBC.
Right.
And this will be recorded on a CD. It's an interesting, again, it's an interesting. The piece itself is about. It's inspired by women troubadours who lived in the medieval. Times. Mm-hmm. I didn't even know that they existed. They existed for about 50 years because that's when the women felt very liberated because the men were gone on the Crusades.
Oh, yeah.
So they felt very free to compose, to sing, to perform.
So are we talking contemporaneous with Hildegard von Bingen?
Right
or
after.
Right after.
Right
that?
After, because these are women, troubadours who wrote not sacred music.
Oh, yeah.
It was, and very, some of the lyrics are very open and very free for mm-hmm. for their times. And it's about a 30-minute work mm-hmm. inspired by medieval troubadour music. And we're going to record, and we're hoping to do a big tour of North America with a program inspired again by troubadour music.
And you say we?
The Manitoba Chamber Orchestra.
With the Manitoba Chamber
accompanying Isabel.
Oh, okay. So this is all interesting. You're a busy man.
Yeah.
Good thing.
I like to keep, I think, because I'd be bored if I would do only one thing. And mm-hmm. I've always tried to do my best in what I can do my best in.
Mm-hmm.
And that has been my motto, in a way.
And your canvas is getting larger by the sound of it.
Yes. Again, quality being a priority. If I see that I'm not going to do a good job at one thing, I just leave it, and I concentrate on things that I believe that I can contribute.
So Amici provides an opportunity to actually bring so many different aspects
definitely.
Of it into one chamber, so to speak.
Definitely.
Very interesting. Thank you so much.
Thank
this
you.
Has been interesting.
Thank you.